Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is consideration of Business Motion 15184 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable for the Stage 3 consideration of the Smoking Prohibition Children in Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill. Could I ask any member who wishes to speak against that motion to press the request to speak button now, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move the motion, please. Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I will now put the question to the Chamber, and the question is that motion number 15184 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. The next item of business then is Stage 3 proceedings on the Smoking Prohibition Children in Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill. And dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is SP Bill 58A, the marshalled list, that is SP Bill 58AML, and the groupings, that is SP Bill 58AG. The division bell will sound and the proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of the afternoon, and the period of voting for the first division will be 30 seconds. Members who wish to speak in the debate on the amendments should press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I would now ask members to please refer to the marshalled list of amendments. And I call Group 1, Offence of Smoking in a Motor Vehicle with Children, Review and Expiry. And I call Amendment 1 in the name of Jackson Carlaw, which is grouped with Amendment 2. And I ask Jackson Carlaw to move Amendment 1 and speak to both amendments in the group. Please, Mr Carlaw.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Nothing that I'm proposing this afternoon is in any way designed to frustrate, delay or impede the progress of the bill in Jim Hume's name that we are going to debate and hopefully approve later this afternoon. We are a unicameral parliament with what many in it have expressed a concern with regard to our competence and post-legislative scrutiny. We are a parliament that is increasingly looking to promote social change through legislative action in terms of seeking to alter the public attitude. I believe in the next Parliament it's conceivable that on the issue of obesity there could be some legislative proposals which come forward before us. And just as we did with alcohol minimum unit pricing, Scottish Conservatives, as a matter of principle, believe that there is an argument in a unicameral Parliament, in one where members have expressed concern about the competence of our post-legislative scrutiny, to require Parliament, after an interval, to commission both a report to establish what the practical consequence of the legislation that we have passed has been. Did it do what we hoped for it? Did it achieve the ends that we set for it? Was it even more successful, in fact, than we had allowed for when it was originally passed? Is, through our post-legislative scrutiny of that particular measure, are we able actually to stand and issue testament to a much wider world that may be looking to us as an example for some of the social progressive health legislation that we pass, to demonstrate what the success of that legislation has been? And if it has been, then it would stand no obstacle in this chamber from subsequently thereafter being reaffirmed. But it would do so on the basis that we had taken the time and the trouble to be certain that the action that we had taken, sometimes in support of measures that we cannot prove at the point that we pass them, but in which we may strongly believe, in which we may strongly hope, but which we are nonetheless approving and passing into legislation in an expectation but not a certainty of success, that in a within a given period of time, and here it is within 5 and 6 years, the government of the day would then commission a report to establish the success or otherwise of the legislation, and also to reaffirm in Parliament its place within the legislative statute. It's as simple as that. I hope that I understand there may not be considerable support for it this afternoon. I hope the principle, at the very least, will register in the minds of people in this Parliament. I don't favour Lord George Foulkes' alternative of a second parliamentary chamber to undertake scrutiny of legislation in this Parliament. I don't think there's any public appetite for it. But we have to recognise that many members have expressed concern about this Parliament's ability to look at the legislation it has passed after it has passed it, after a period of time to establish that it has been effective. And the amendments I present this afternoon, as we did within the Alcohol Minimum Unit Pricing Bill, as we will do in future social legislation and attempts to affect the better health of Scotland through the legislative process, we will do so in the knowledge that we propose an amendment such as this in order that Parliament has the confidence to review what it has done and to reaffirm it if it has been successful or otherwise. And I move the amendments in my name.
Many thanks. I now call on Malcolm Chisholm.
I think, Presiding Officer, no one would object to the principle of post-legislative scrutiny, and we certainly need to have more of that than we've had in the past. But to propose a specific sunset clause, because I think that's what it in practice is on this bill, does seem to me to be rather odd, and I don't think we can have a general rule that every piece of legislation has such a clause. So I think we have to be very careful about which pieces of legislation attracts this particular clause. And Jackson Carlow mentioned the minimum pricing, and well, as is well known, I did support that. But you know, I think you know it's fairly new territory, and people weren't absolutely certain of the consequences of it. So there was some argument in favour of a sunset clause for that bill. But I struggle to understand the rationale for a sunset clause on this particular piece of legislation, firstly because it is actually, I mean, this is, you know, it's all going to come up in the open debate, obviously, but it's preempting, it's extending what is in fact an existing piece of legislation. The science about smoking in enclosed spaces is not in doubt. It's been tried in other countries successfully and so on. So I think there's a whole series of facts that would make it highly improbable, if not impossible, that that we would change our mind on this piece of legislation. And in terms of a wind-up, I would ask Jackson Carlow to envisage a situation in which we would change our mind on this legislation, because even if you know, it was established that not a large number of people had been found guilty of an offence, I mean, that doesn't mean that legislation didn't work. It might act as a deterrent. Hopefully it will. The reality is we know the science on this, and so I just can't imagine circumstances in which we would change our mind about it. So while not disagreeing with the general tenor of what he said in terms of let's look at legislation that we've passed, I certainly oppose these particular amendments on this particular bill.
Thank you. Jenny Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I say to Jackson Carlow, I have a lot of sympathy with the principle of these amendments and have argued in this chamber and in committees in this Parliament before for increased post-legislative scrutiny. I think it's something that across the board we do not do enough of. But I do agree with my colleague Malcolm Chisholm's comments that actually I think it is perhaps a dangerous precedent to set that we put into legislation the requirement for post-legislative scrutiny rather than making the strong assumption that this is something that Parliament will undertake itself. And regarding the sunset clause, I also agree with my colleague Malcolm Chisholm. I think anyone, any member of the public looking very closely at today's debate might interpret a sunset clause that we intend to revisit this legislation, or may interpret that we are not entirely serious about its implementation, which may then affect compliance. And as I will say later on in the debate this afternoon, I think it's very clear from the smoking ban in public places that there was generally widespread, very good compliance with that legislation, and I would expect exactly the same in this bill too.
Thank you. Mike McKenzie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Jackson Carlow hasn't had the benefit, as I had, of sitting through the scrutiny of the bill in the Health Committee. And therefore, I think what he's been expressing is a kind of general antipathy towards the notion of government attempting to improve the health of children, trying to prevent the detriment to their health, or indeed Jim Hume trying to protect children's health. The point I would make to him is that it would be impossible after the fact, after this legislation is enacted and comes into force and runs even for several years, to examine the benefits in any scientifically meaningful way. It will be impossible to evaluate and to quantify the improvement to children's health that will be affected as a result of this piece of legislation. And yet I don't think anybody in this chamber would seriously argue that preventing adults from smoking in the enclosed space of a car in the company of small children is not a good thing. So what he seems to be arguing against is the ability, the idea that this Parliament should deign to intervene in people's lives at any level in order to improve and protect the health of our children. And that strikes me as a very, very curious position to take. So I hope that members will not support this amendment when we're voting on it.
Many thanks. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I will speak to Amendments 1 and 2, and I welcome the opportunity to set out the Scottish Government's position on these amendments in Jackson Carlaw's name. I must admit that I too was surprised both by Jackson Carlaw lodging this amendment and the reasons he expressed for doing so. At stage one, he made reference to constructing an artificial debate. It is my view that there's nothing artificial about this debate. The harms of secondhand smoke are well established by evidence. There is widespread public and stakeholder support for this measure. It's therefore not clear to me what is artificial about this debate. Mr. Carlaw described these measures as an ambitious but speculative public health measure. A number of countries have adopted similar legislation to protect children. In that respect, there is nothing speculative about it. Furthermore, this is not the first time that we have implemented smoke-free legislation in Scotland aimed at reducing the harms of secondhand smoke. I see no reason for the provisions of the bill to cease to have effect in 6 years. It's important that protection continues to be afforded to children in the long term. In relation to Amendment 2, I can understand the desire to review whether the objectives of the bill have been achieved. However, this is only one measure that is being introduced to achieve these aims. There are a number of other tobacco policies that will impact on these, such as the Take It Right Outside campaign. Further legislation aimed at denormalising smoking, such as plain packaging, and measures included in the health bill. I agree, as others have said, that of course there is a need for post-legislative scrutiny and for committees to do that, but I really don't think that this is a good example on which to pin that. The idea that after 6 years, that somehow, whether this has been a success or a failure, that we go back and allow smoking in cars is quite abhorrent to me. And I think it's worth noting that smoking prevalence numbers in Scotland dropped from 23 to 20% between 2013 and 2014. It makes sense that as prevalence falls, the number of young people exposed to smoking and secondhand smoke will also decrease. Yeah, of course.
Jenny Madden.
I thank the Minister very much for giving way. This is a figure we have debated in the Chamber before, the drop in smoking from 23 to 20%. Does she have any evidence of where that drop has come from or if it is due to the use of e-cigarettes?
Minister.
Well, I think, as we know, that some of it can be put down to the use of e-cigarettes, but we know that e-cigarettes are one way of stopping smoking, and stopping smoking using e-cigarettes and the other cessation measures available in the NHS all contribute to the drop in secondhand in smoking. So what I want to emphasise, Presiding Officer, is success cannot be determined by enforcement alone. I believe that the aims of the bill and their success should be considered as part of wider tobacco control measures in Scotland, and I think that was the point that Mike McKenzie was making. There are a number of data sources in place to measure progress towards these aims, and I'd be happy to keep the Scottish Parliament updated on progress. So for these reasons, I do not support these amendments.
Thank you, Minister. Jim Hume.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I also thank Jackson Carlaw for lodging these amendments, number 1 and 2, if at least for allowing me to explain why I don't believe they're required in this bill. But I do appreciate that the member is using this bill to make a point about post-legislative scrutiny. And no doubt that will become more of an issue, especially with the extra pressure on the Parliament's timetable with new powers on their way. But effectiveness of legislation shouldn't simply be about how enforceable it is or the number of prosecutions or fines handed out. It can be effective by acting as a deterrent and tackling social norms. There is clear evidence of the positive impact of similar legislation in other countries. In South Australia, around 88% of cars are smoke-free. In Canada, there is an almost immediate 33% reduction in smoking in vehicles. Other places, there are suggestions that people thought about the impact of their smoking anywhere in the presence of children. Particularly welcome when it would simply not be reasonable to apply this legislation to what people do in their own homes. There is already a degree of public awareness of this bill. I expect that this will increase when it is supported by a high-profile campaign, which the Scottish Government has already committed to doing. This, I think, will work towards tackling social norms and make people think twice. As I've said previously, in many cases, it is not the fear of being caught that changes people's behaviours, but the concerns that their actions are not socially acceptable. The ban on smoking in public places mentioned by Jenny Mara did not contain a sunset clause, and I think the vast majority of us would actually acknowledge that that has been a great success. This bill is widely supported. Almost all the respondents to the Health and Sport Committee's call for evidence supported the bill. More widely, public opinion already appears to be on the side of the bill. 85% of Scottish adults and 72% of smokers support the bill. That doesn't give any impression of any public scepticism. The bill's straightforward. I want it to stay that way, and I do not believe that it requires a sunset clause. Therefore, I shall not be supportive of Mr Carlow's amendments today.
Many thanks. And can I now invite Jackson Carlow to wind up, and please indicate, Mr Carlow, if you intend to press or withdraw.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I've indicated, Scottish Conservatives support the bill, and we will be supporting it at decision time tonight. The two clauses, the second one is a requirement for Parliament to undertake a report of the effectiveness of the legislation. And in response to Malcolm Chisholm, I suppose I would say it would allow us to see whether the number of prosecutions for individuals had risen or decreased, whether in fact a report recommended there should be a broader level of the number of people who were empowered to enforce the legislation, whether in fact e-cigarettes had proved to be a problematic contradiction within the legislation, and that they too should be subject to inclusion within the provision. I can think of alcohol legislation that we have passed in this Parliament on the restriction of sale on particular offers. I don't think we have ever subsequently discussed what the effectiveness of any of that legislation has actually proved to be in public health. Now, that isn't an argument against passing the legislation in the first place, but it is an argument that says that in a unicameral parliament that has a lot of legislation going through the committee system, which is largely conducting its business on the progression of government legislation, that there should be a requirement in this parliament to occasionally, particularly where it has taken public health actions to change public mind, to look at what it did to see how effective it was. Now, in this instance, I agree. And on the Smoking in Public Places Bill, I don't think there would have been any question of this Parliament if it had to reaffirm the legislation not doing so. But it would have done so on the back of a report to Parliament, which would actually have detailed considerably how beneficial that legislation had been. In this instance, it would have demonstrated exactly how beneficial it would have been. But we seem to lack the courage to do that. We simply pass the legislation and move on and hope for the best. That's not the best way to carry public opinion. And in some of the public health legislation that I believe the government may think is worth attempting in the next Parliament, if we don't have the confidence of that level of scrutiny, it will prove divisive rather than unifying when it doesn't mean to be. So I will press the amendments in my name, one which, of course, is a sunset clause, one which simply calls for a proper report of the legislation that takes place. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. The question then is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament has not agreed. There will be a division. As this is the first division of the stage, the Parliament is now suspended for 5 minutes. Order. We'll now proceed with the division on Amendment 1. This is a 30-second division, and members should please cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 1 is yes 11, no 94, there were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I now call amendment 2 in the name of Jackson Carlaw, already debated with amendment 1, and I ask Jackson Carlaw, order please, ask Jackson Carlaw to move or not move.
Moved.
The member has moved. The question is that amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. This is a 30-second division. Please vote now. Order, please. The result of the vote on amendment number 2 is yes 14, no 95. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. That ends consideration of amendments. Could members leaving the chamber please do so quietly? The next item of business is a debate on motion number 15146 in the name of Jim Hume on the Smoking Prohibition Children in Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill. Could I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now? Could I invite all other members to take their conversations outside of this chamber, please? I now call on Jim Hume to speak to and move the motion. 10 minutes, please, Mr Hume.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. It gives me great pleasure to open this afternoon's debate on the Smoking Prohibition Children in Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill, which I move in my name. The bill was introduced 1 year ago this week on the 15th of December 2014. Stage one was completed on the 8th of October with a very positive debate in this very chamber, when the general principles were unanimously agreed to. The bill was, of course, considered at stage two by the Health and Sport Committee on the 17th of November, and now a month on, we debate the final stage of the amended bill, which I hope and believe will be passed at decision time today. So before outlining the changes to the bill agreed at stage two, I would, of course, like to thank those who have been involved at various points in the process, not least the Health and Sport Committee for its detailed scrutiny of the bill. A quick look at that committee's work programme shows how busy it is, so I'm extremely grateful to them all. I'd also like to note my thanks to the Non-Governmental Bills Unit, in particular Stephen Fricker, Joe Hardy, Claire O'Neill and the rest of the team. I'd also like to thank my own parliamentary team, past and present, Craig Moran, Fiona Milne and Eliana Kazakiew. Their hard work has made this bill possible. And of course there have been many organisations and individuals that have made their mark too, such as the British Heart Foundation, Lung Foundation, Marie Curie, Cancer Research UK and the BMA. There was a Dr Nina Rawadjur and in particular Dr Sean Semple, whose research has been used for much of this bill. Many thanks to them all and of course for their valuable input and support going back about 3 years in total. And of course the thanks, of course, again to the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for its continued scrutiny of the sub-leg powers. And of course, I better and must also reiterate my thanks to the Minister and her officials. Their positive and very constructive approach has been helpful, especially throughout the last year and recent months. My consultation on this bill generated wide support, and the responses produced some clear themes which helped to develop and refine the policy, particularly around the age of those to be protected and the level of the fixed penalty. I'm grateful to the many people and organisations that inputted into this bill, some 160 responses to the consultation, and the vast amount of those were in support. Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to remind the Chamber of the aim of this piece of legislation. It is to protect our children and young people from the harmful effects of exposure to secondhand smoke within the very close confines of a motor vehicle, where the concentrations of harmful particles are significant, around 11 times denser than the smoke in bars that we've already legislated for. Another statistic that I regularly referred to throughout Stage 1 was the 60,000 children that are put in this position each week in Scotland. 60,000, Deputy Presiding Officer. To put that in context, that's equivalent of the combined population of Dumfries, Hawick and Galashiels, or more people than can actually fit into Hampden Park Stadium. So to ensure the protection of children, it will be an offence for an adult to smoke in a private motor vehicle when a child is present. An adult being defined as a person aged 18 or over, a child under 18. Public vehicles and, of course, work vehicles are already covered by the existing legislation. The committee had suggested that it should be an offence for the driver of a vehicle to fail to prevent smoking by another adult, and Malcolm Chisholm came forward with that amendment at Stage 2. But I'm pleased that the committee accepted my arguments against this at that stage. I believe the focus must be on the health of the child and the one that is causing the harm, the actual smoker. So turning to the key amendments to the bill that were agreed at Stage 2, the fixed penalty regime, the schedule to the bill now provides for joint enforcement of the fixed penalty regime by Police Scotland and also the local authorities. I work closely with the Scottish Government to ensure that the regime is as similar as possible to that which applies to the ban on smoking in public places. The benefits, in my belief, are threefold. It strengthens the bill without making it unnecessarily complicated or burdensome, and in turn, enforcement will be simpler for police and local authorities as they're already familiar with that regime. The result will be to afford better protection to our children and young people. Aspects that remain from the schedule as introduced are the fixed penalty itself to be set at £100, although there is a provision for Scottish ministers to amend this by regulations. The period for payment is 29 days without a provision for any early payment discount. Local authorities will have the discretion to extend the period for payment if they so wish. I believe that this is proportionate but also provides flexibility for changing circumstances. It's likely there will be some minor one-off additional costs to local authorities, and these have all been addressed in the revised financial memorandum. Section 5 allows for commencement of the provisions to be set by Scottish ministers. This will allow the measures to coincide with a national campaign to raise awareness of the new offence. So I've been encouraged by the minister's clear commitment to this legislation, and I welcome the high profile that it will be given to such an important new law. Members will be aware of the Scottish Government's Take It Right Outside campaign that the Minister mentioned in amendment stage there, which has had a good effect. So I will explore options to strengthen the campaign in my closing speech. The Minister lodged amendments to change the term human habitation to living accommodation, remove the reference to not less than one night, and remove the defence that a person smoking reasonably believed all other occupants of the vehicle to be adults. The Minister may expand on these in her contribution, but I was happy to support those amendments as they provide clarity and are consistent with the policy intention. During the Stage 1 debate, a number of members, including Jenny Mara, Carr Helton, Richard Lyle, quoted Cancer Research UK, They highlighted that in Scotland, a private vehicle remains one of the few places where children can legally be exposed to tobacco smoke. So if passed, this legislation will, of course, address that situation and help to ensure that all our children and young people have the best and healthiest start in life. I believe the provisions in this bill are clearly understood and enforceable. I also believe it will be effective in encouraging a culture shift and challenging social norms, which will have a positive impact on future generations for years to come. Of course, I'll take an intervention.
Jenny Mara. I thank the member very much indeed for giving way, and I'll come on to congratulate him on his bill. But I wanted to ask him in his opening remarks if, in the course of considering all the evidence on the extension, really, of the smoking ban to cars, did he consider the issue of smoking in tenement buildings in the shared and common areas? There is a problem there, but they are many are privately owned but publicly used. Did he see evidence for that, and does he think that's something worth of debate in this chamber?
Jim. That was not part of the consultation at all. It was very clear that we were concentrating absolutely on motor vehicles, and that's what was consulted on. So we did not consult on that at all, but may be interesting to explore perhaps in the next Parliament. As the Minister and others said at stage one, almost 10 years on from the ban on smoking in public places, it's difficult to imagine smoking in workplaces or restaurants now. Christian Allard, in the last stage one, he said that I hope that in years to come people will be shocked to know that it was ever possible to smoke in a vehicle when children were present. So in concluding, Presiding Officer, I would once again like to thank those many involved for their very collaborative approach. I look forward to listening to contributions from across the chamber. This is a popular bill. Nearly all respondents to the Health and Sports Committee call for evidence supported it, and as many have observed that 85% of Scottish adults, including 72% of smokers, do support it. This bill again shows how this Scottish Parliament has led the way in all of the UK in starting the debate on protecting children from second-hand smoking cars. Today we have the chance to make that a law that will save millions of pounds to the purse of the NHS, but more importantly, without doubt, will make so many more people lead a better, a healthier life, a life without asthma, lung infections, sudden infant death syndrome, and the ravages of lung cancer. A healthier future, thanks to all of you who support this bill today. 60,000 children per week are exposed to second-hand smoke in cars every week in Scotland alone. About the number of the people in one Scottish parliamentary constituency, 60,000 children are being exposed to second-hand smoke, with around 50 toxins and carcinogens in that smoke. 60,000 children that don't have the option but to go into that smoke-filled car in their trip to their relatives, school, or perversely their sports event. 60,000 children of the future that we can all help today by supporting this bill. A bill that will save millions to the public purse and help many souls in generations to come to have a healthier start to life. Our job as MSPs is to make a difference. I think today we can make a real difference. As I said, I move the motion in my name that Parliament agrees that the Smoking Prohibition Children in Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill be passed, and hope for support across the Parliament at decision time today. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call in Maureen Watt, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Jim Hume on proposing the bill, and I thank him very much for working closely with the Scottish Government over the past few months so that we could improve its provisions together. The bill, as has been said, has enjoyed cross-party support throughout its parliamentary progress. Central to the debate on this bill is the fact that smoking remains the primary preventable cause of ill health and death in Scotland, ultimately killing one in two long-term users. This costs the NHS as much as up to £500 million each year. The evidence on the harmful effects of second-hand smoke is also well evidenced and understood. That is why continuing to protect people, especially children, from second-hand smoke is a key. While existing smoke-free legislation has undoubtedly made a difference, children can still be exposed to second-hand smoke in cars and homes. Where children are medically at risk due conditions such as asthma, the harmful effects can be especially severe. We know that there has consistently been strong public and stakeholder support for this legislation. At the end of last year, we consulted on similar measures. 79% of those who responded thought it should be an offence. A survey earlier this year suggested that 85% of adults in Scotland supported a ban on smoking in cars when children and young people under aged 18 are present, including the majority of smokers. And Mr Hume's consultation for this bill demonstrated a similarly high level of support, with 84% of respondents supporting the principles of the bill. That level of support has been reflected in the cross-party support for the bill. I was pleased that the Health and Sport Committee supported my amendments at stage two. Amongst other changes, they removed some problematic aspects of the bill, such as the defence and one of the tests for exempting vehicles, which are also people's homes. The removal of these provisions from the bill will make enforcement easier. I was also happy to support the amendment put forward by Mr Hume at stage two, which will see a joint enforcement role between Police Scotland and local authority environmental health officers. Environmental health officers have played a vital role in the implementation of current smoke-free legislation. Protecting public health is fundamental to the role of environmental health officers in Scotland, and they bring with them a wealth of experience. However, whilst enforcement of this offence will be important, the aims of the bill cannot be achieved by enforcement alone. This is about promoting a change in cultures and attitudes. We know that the harms caused by exposure to secondhand smoke are widely understood, and therefore the majority of adults choose not to smoke in their homes and cars when children are present. We developed our national campaign, Take It Right Outside. This aims to raise awareness of the risks posed by secondhand smoke to children. I launched that campaign last year to a positive reception. It's my belief that the introduction of this offence will provide a deterrent and continue to promote this key message. We know that there have been a significant change in behaviours and attitudes since the introduction of smoke-free legislation in 2006. Enforcement in respect of that legislation was measured, and we would anticipate the same approach to the proposals in the bill. When these important provisions are commenced, they will contribute to the commitment to reduce the amount of children exposed to secondhand smoke to 6% by 2020. In 2014, that figure was 11%. We have seen amendments put forward today seeking a statutory review of these measures. However, this is only one measure that will contribute to reducing children's exposure to secondhand smoke and to reducing children's exposure to smoking behaviour.
Jenny Manning.
The Minister for giving way, Presiding Officer. On the same point that I made to Jim Hume about protecting children from smoke, will her government consider legislating on smoke in tenement buildings and shared stairwells? Because many children, and I'm sure she's had representations from constituents on this like I have, are exposed to smoke in their own closes where they live.
Minister.
Well, in relation to that, yes, I have had representations from members and others through my correspondence as a minister. The introduction of such measures are not without its challenges. We are looking at that. But I think the message of taking it right outside does mean that you just don't go into the close, that you take it right outside the building. And we can certainly see that that is having an effect. The Scottish Government will continue to progress a number of other measures to contribute towards these aims. So this bill cannot be considered in isolation. As I said earlier, I'm happy to report the Scottish Government's progress towards these ambitious targets to this Parliament at any time. I would like to see all children in Scotland protected from the harms of secondhand smoke in vehicles as quickly as possible. As I've said previously, raising awareness of this offence will be an important part of ensuring compliance with the law. We have therefore committed to delivering an awareness campaign to make the public aware of the change in the law, and we will do this as quickly as we can. Scotland can be proud that it has proven itself to be a world leader on tobacco control. This is an important piece of legislation in ensuring every child in Scotland has the best start in life, and I'm pleased that the bill has received strong cross-party support throughout the Parliament's consideration of it. So I thank Jim Hume for his work on this, and the Government is very supportive of the bill.
Many thanks. I now call on Jenny Mara. 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The last bill of the year of 2015 is very well scheduled, as we woke up this morning to a new report about cancer and its risk factors. In debates in this chamber, we generally say that 40% of cancers are preventable. But this morning's report from the Stony Brook Cancer Centre in New York says that cancer is overwhelmingly the result of environmental factors, and that only 10 to 30% of cancers are just down to the way that the body naturally functions. Now, there was a variety of reactions to this report this morning, but I think the evidence is gathering pace every year that there is more and more evidence that environmental factors are leading to cancer. And I did wonder this morning, as I woke up to the radio, if Jim Hume himself had primed the New York researchers to release their findings just this morning ahead of his bill. Because I think there's little doubt that more and more needs to be done to improve environmental factors and prevent environmental factors that can lead to cancer. Presiding Officer, Ash Scotland says that one-fifth of 13 to 15-year-olds are exposed to smoke in cars. And Jim Hume himself cites very compelling figures of 60,000 children today exposed to smoke in that small enclosed space of a motor car. And when I think back to jobs that I have had personally in bars, exposed for hours on end to a thick fog of smoke when I was a student 20 years ago, and the stench of smoke on my hair and clothes when I finished my shift, these are conditions that we simply would not tolerate now. It is not culturally acceptable. And it was the smoking ban in public places that created the tipping point for this behaviour. It was bold and brave legislation that was initially branded, of course, as crazy, but when it was enacted, people changed and complied with it, more or less overnight, because they knew deep down that it was the right thing to do and it made sense for themselves, their own health, and the health of the people around them. And this is exactly what I expect to happen with this bill today. People, I think, will look back and think it crazy that we allowed smoke to permeate such a small enclosed space, exposing other passengers to that danger, as in a motor car. And, Presiding Officer, I am well aware of the libertarian arguments about personal volition in private spaces, which is a motor car, and I do have a lot of sympathy with these libertarian arguments. However, when we have such a broad consensus for a publicly funded health service provided for through taxation, then it is incumbent on us as custodians of that health service to make sure it is sustainable into the long term. And the millions of pounds that smoking costs our health service is simply not sustainable. And that is why we need to legislate to improve environmental factors as well as people's health, and this bill does exactly that. Presiding Officer, Labour voted against the amendments lodged by the Conservatives this afternoon because the First Amendment was effectively a sunset clause asking the government to review the legislation after 5 years. And as I have already outlined, I think this bill is really an addendum to the smoking ban in public places. It will create a culture change, will generally garner compliance, and therefore I don't think that sunset clause is necessary. And the second, as I explained earlier, for post-legislative scrutiny, I think the Parliament should be doing as a matter of course, but I was sympathetic to Jackson Carlaw's arguments that actually we need to be making public health policy on the basis of evidence, and I hope the Government will have heard that message loud and clear. But, Presiding Officer, I do believe that the public will comply because they know and understand the arguments on this. Smokers themselves know the dangers of their smoke, but as we know, there are barriers, poverty and environmental, to them quitting. I do predict that in 30 years' time, we will have a smoke-free Scotland and we will look back and wonder how tobacco companies ever exploited our health and put the massive burden on the NHS that they do now. But in this vein, Presiding Officer, I think it's worrying that we've not had debates on the big issues in public health in this country outside the legislative programme. Now, this morning's news should give the Scottish Government real food for thought. With the worrying cancer statistics that came out in Scotland just this week, coupled with this morning's evidence that far more incidences of cancer than we thought are probably preventable, then anyone serious about long-term sustainability of the health service should be taking a preventative agenda very seriously indeed. Presiding Officer, why not make next year the year of prevention? We expect a new tobacco strategy in 2017, but I think the Scottish Government should bring a debate much earlier than that. On diet, we have not seen any initiative I can think of from the Scottish Government over the last few years to improve our relationship with fat and sugar. The Minister's shaking her head. She might come back to this and explain what it has been. And on alcohol, the Scottish Government has been content to leave their efforts on alcohol to minimum pricing, which is currently tied up in the courts. Now, I don't
the
think
member's
I have,
going to
with
have
respect,
to close,
I don't
I'm
think
afraid.
I have time. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, can I thank and congratulate Jim Hume on taking some very powerful vested interest to task by getting this bill passed today? I know the work that goes into bringing a member's bill to fruition, and he has guided the whole process with his own hands. A worthy legacy for a health spokesperson, and we are delighted to support it at decision time tonight.
Thank you. And to now call on Jackson Carlaw. 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin where Jenny Mara finished and congratulate Jim Hume on the progress of his private member's bill through to a decision tonight that I think will be supported unanimously by the Parliament. And I welcome that. Beyond that, much of the debate has already been had and everything has been said. So there are only 2 points I would make. The first is that we have to hope this legislation is exemplary and that it has the influence on public opinion that we'd all wish it to have. Because none of us, I think, would like to see any great resource having to be deployed in its enforcement, and there could be issues around the practicality of that. So what we want to happen is for public attitude to be changed. Secondly, I wasn't myself, I mean, I very much would have liked this legislation to have been in place when I was myself a child. I think I said in the stage one debate that I have horrendous memories of my father puffing away on the cigar, I think, that was branded Happiness Is, for those of you who remember back to these things, the lining, the white, and we were in the retail motor industry, so we had my father had a new car every 6 months. But by the end, because it was sold as a second-hand vehicle, but by the end of the 6 months, the white felt lining of the vehicle was invariably a ghastly, treacly yellow colour, and I, you know, remember journeys, some of which were 5.5 hours long, where my sister and I endured what really was the most ghastly experience. What it did to us, I've absolutely no idea. But that I, you know, was almost resolved then that smoking was a filthy, noxious habit that I would be very happy to see curtailed in any way whatsoever, and that any child today should be subjected to that, I think, quite unconscionable. And I think I also mentioned going home from school in the days when it was still bench seats in the buses and having to use a knife and fork to find a space through the smoke to even identify where a vacant seat might be. I mean, that was the culture of the time, and it's gone. And this residual smoking in vehicles, which I think, of course, must be damaging to the health of everyone, irrespective of whether they're a child, but the legislative aim today is not to subject children to that legislation, will make a difference and is worthwhile. I'd like to have thought that, in fact, social attitudes had changed to the extent that the legislation wouldn't be necessary. But interestingly, I was coming into Parliament in a taxi last week, and the taxi driver said to me, as a matter, he'd heard it on the radio, and so he thought he'd conduct a wee experiment. So he had spent the morning driving around Edinburgh in his taxi, counting the number of vehicles he saw within that shift where adults were smoking with young children in the car. And there were 16 examples within the four-hour period in the immediate inner city environment within Edinburgh. So whatever the common sense understanding of how this must affect children might be, the reality is it continues. And we need to send a strong message. It is a legislative message that I hope will prove to be exemplary, that I hope will change public attitudes. And as I say, I congratulate Jim Hume on the bill that he is that will be passed later on this afternoon.
Thank you. We now turn to the open debate. Speeches of 6 minutes, please. Stuart Maxwell, to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I begin, like others, by adding my congratulations to Jim Hume on getting his Smoking Prohibition Children in Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill to Stage 3. I mean, I laid my motion to introduce a bill to ban smoking in enclosed public places in the middle of 2003. And looking back over the last 12 years, it seems to me, standing here today, that it's rather astonishing to see the distance we have travelled in the fight against the scourge of tobacco and its impacts on our society. And I think it was Jenny Mara earlier who said, when the legislation was first thought of, or thought that we would maybe introduce it, it was seen as ridiculous. It was seen as a crazy idea, and many, in fact, ridiculed the actual prospect of a smoking ban in enclosed public places in Scotland, and said, in fact, to me several times that they would never see it in their lifetime. Yet only a couple of years later, the ban was in place and was respected. Now, I have no doubt that this particular bill puts another brick into the road that we are building towards a smoke-free Scotland. It's an important piece of public health legislation, and one which will undoubtedly improve the health of children in Scotland. It is a very clear and a very focused piece of legislation aimed at tackling one problem, the exposure of children to tobacco smoke in cars. Now, the Scottish Schools Adolescent Lifestyle and Substance Abuse Survey for 2013 reported that 22% of Scottish children aged 13 to 15 are sometimes or often exposed to tobacco smoke in the car. Now, that's nearly a quarter of our adolescents are exposed to pollution levels, which are often higher than those in Beijing or Delhi. And don't forget that last weekend, the smog in Beijing was so bad that children and elderly people were told to stay at home and not to venture outside. However, some people seem to think that that's all right to expose their own children and other people's children to that level of pollution. Now, smoking among 13 to 15-year-olds has now reached the lowest levels since we started doing modern surveys of smoking amongst this demographic group. So young people themselves are choosing to turn away from the dangers of tobacco. And I believe that it's only right that we should support them by passing legislation which protects them from other people's unhealthy choices when they are too young to be able to make that choice for themselves. Children are more in need of protection than other groups in society for two reasons. One is that they are dependent upon adults. They have little or no autonomy. And the other reason is that children are much more vulnerable to secondhand smoke than adults due to their smaller lung capacity and, of course, their faster breathing rate. Now, we tend to think only of asthma and other respiratory diseases when considering secondhand smoke. But the Royal College of Physicians produced a report in 2010 entitled Passive Smoking and Children, in which they estimated that 1 in 5 of every sudden infant deaths could be attributed to passive smoking. Now, I think that's a terrifying and a shocking statement. And for that reason alone, even if no other, we should pass this legislation this evening. Now, I'm pleased to note that the bill has been amended so that responsibility for enforcement is shared between Police Scotland and local authorities. I think that was a smart move at stage two. Yes, I will.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. He mentions enforcement, and I just wonder if he is convinced, as I think Mr Hume is convinced, that this is actually going to work, because I see a lot of drivers still using their mobile phones in their cars. That is not enforced widely, although some people are caught. Does he really think this is going to work and be enforced?
Stuart Maxwell.
Well, strangely enough, that was echoes of the arguments of 2003, 4 and 5 in advance of the legislation coming. I think there is a difference. Many people do not recognise the dangers of the distraction that using a mobile phone in a car causes. I think there is nobody in our society that doesn't recognise the dangers of secondhand smoke and smoking. Yes, taking up intervention.
Sorry, Jim Hume.
Thank you. I thank the member for taking intervention. Just provide clarity. It is a misconception that there's no enforcement of mobile phones or using seatbelts. I think the last figures I saw were about 13,000 people in Scotland in 1 year actually being fined for using their mobile phones in cars.
Stuart Maxwell.
Can I thank Mr Hume for those statistics? But I think, and I think probably like him, I think that the general public will accept this in a similar way that they accepted the original smoking ban in enclosed public places, because the levels of support are clear from the survey evidence, and I think people understand the dangers, not only to themselves, but also particularly to children. But I'm aware that the Scottish Government, Police Scotland and the Royal Environmental Health Institute of Scotland all supported this multimodal approach to enforcement, believing that the legislation would have more impact if this amendment was introduced. And I'm glad that this advice has been listened to and that change made. We know that more than a fifth of our adolescents are exposed to second-hand smoke in cars, and we also know that similar legislation is already in place in Australia and Canada and is working very well. France introduced a ban in the summer, and England and Wales enforced the ban at the beginning of October. It's also clear that this bill is likely to be popular with the Scottish public. The Health and Sport Committee found that 93% of the respondents to their call for written evidence supported the bill's general principles, and a YouGov survey commissioned by Ash Scotland found that 85% of adults and 72% of adult smokers supported the introduction of a ban on smoking in vehicles carrying children.
Mr Maxwell, could you begin to conclude?
Yeah, I am. Thank you, Presiding Officer. The public are in favour of this legislation. Health professionals are in favour of this legislation. And I think that the time is ripe for us to protect our children and move Scotland towards a smoke-free future. Once again, I'd like to congratulate Jim Hume, and I will vote for this legislation at decision time with a great deal of pleasure.
Thank you. I call Malcolm Chisholm and I apologise. It should be speeches of 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I congratulate Jim Hume on introducing this bill, which I'm sure everyone will vote for at decision time. In a sense, we've been over some of the arguments when we were debating the amendments. And as I said then, the science on this is not in doubt. It already works well in other countries such as Australia and Canada, and indeed has started recently in England as well. But most of all, it is an extension of existing provision, and through the course of the debates 10 and more years ago, I think everyone now accepts the arguments about the consequences of second-hand smoke for those who are inhaling it but not actually smoking it. And I think it would be appropriate once again in this year when Tom McCabe has tragically died to pay tribute to his work on that bill, because although I was the Minister for Health when the consultation was launched, I know better than anyone that it was he who actually drove this forward and did the work on it. Now, what we're told, of course, is that bad as second-hand smoke is everywhere, it's actually particularly bad and in small enclosed spaces such as cars. And in fact, there was a fairly staggering statistic that levels increase in spaces such as cars to over 11 times those of a smoky pub. So, in a sense, there's a particular need for legislation for enclosed public spaces. And, of course, on top of that, we have the particular problems that children receive. And, again, the briefing we got from Cancer Research UK was very useful in that regard. They talked about a cotinine indicator used to measure second-hand smoke exposure. And they said that this indicator showed that that levels were 70% higher in children than in adults. And they also referred to statistics about 165,000 cases of diseases among children across the UK caused by second-hand smoke. And perhaps Richard Simpson will go more into the details of that. But as Stuart Maxwell said, a lot of them are respiratory diseases, but not all of them respiratory diseases. Now, I was on the Health Committee for Stage 2, although not for Stage 1, and briefly then talk about the amendments. Obviously, one's been referred to in terms of the joint enforcement, and picking up the point about the early legislation, that mirrors now the provisions of the smoking bill. And I myself moved an amendment, as Jim Hume says, but I was persuaded by his arguments that it was better to keep the bill simple and have the focus on the health of children and the offending smoker, keeping the drivers out of it. Now, I think there is an important opportunity now to educate people about the harm caused by second-hand smoke. Clearly, there will have to be a campaign in relation to this specific offence, but as part of that, I'm sure the wider messages about the dangers of second-hand smoke can be emphasised, and that, of course, will be entirely useful in all sorts of ways. Now, as Jenny Mara emphasised, action on smoking has to be right at the top of the agenda on public health. And I hope the government will still be looking at a range of measures. We've come a long way on smoking, but it doesn't necessarily have to be the end of the road, because we're not actually going fast enough towards the target. I think it's 5% of people smoking by the mid-2030s, although some people might want to amend that to nobody smoking by that time. So, I mean, one specific issue that Jenny Mara mentioned, smoking in tenements and what we in Edinburgh would call the stair rather than the close air, I think that's brought up with me, as with many others, and I think that is an area that the government could look at. But clearly we talked about other measures as part of the e-cigarette bill. I won't go into those controversies today in case I get into another argument with Stuart Maxwell about that. But one last point is the health inequalities dimension of smoking, because of those who are smoking, it's still, I think, four times as many in the most disadvantaged areas compared to the most affluent. So action on smoking is also an action against health inequalities as well as for public health more generally.
Many thanks. And we now move to closing speeches. I call on Dr. Nanette Milne. 4 minutes are thereby, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As we round off our work on this piece of legislation, I'd like to add my thanks to the witnesses who gave both written and oral evidence to the Health and Sport Committee as we scrutinised the bill. And I'd particularly like to thank the committee clerks and the SPICE team for their help in bringing that evidence together into our committee report. Because as we near the end of this parliamentary session, the Health Committee is, as Jim Hume indicated, dealing with a particularly heavy legislation agenda, and we simply couldn't get through it without the hard work of the people I've mentioned. I'd also like to congratulate Jim Hume on the work that he has put into formulating the bill and on securing the government support, without which it wouldn't have come to fruition. There's no doubt that in the decades since the legislation to ban smoking in public places was enacted, we've seen a transformational change in attitudes to smoking and an increasing public realisation of the harmful effects of not only the active smoking of tobacco, but also of the passive inhalation of tobacco products. This, I'm sure, accounts for the widespread support that this legislation has received from the public, with 85% of Scottish adults agreeing with it, including 72% of smokers themselves. There's no doubt that levels of passive smoke in cars can be very high, as we've heard from Jackson Carlow from his childhood experiences, because of the restricted area in which it can circulate. And it's been shown that air conditioning or opening of the windows doesn't remove the associated risks to the people who are shut into this confined space. As children are particularly vulnerable because of their developing respiratory systems and rapid breathing, of course it's right to protect them from smoke inhalation when they're in vehicles with adults who may be smoking tobacco products. Our concern hasn't been with the principle of protecting people under 18 from the harmful effects of secondhand smoke, but rather with the problems we foresee there may be in enforcing the legislation, as suggested by John Mason in this debate. That's why we sought to have the impact of the bill assessed by Parliament a few years after it's enacted, a view shared by the Law Society of Scotland, to ensure that young people are in fact being protected by the legislation. I really do feel that in a Parliament without a revising chamber and the pressure of working on this Health Committee, such that post-legislative scrutiny of the laws we approve is well nigh impossible, it will become increasingly important to include clauses in public health legislation which will enforce the examination of its impact on modifying public opinion. However, it is clear that Parliament is not yet prepared to accept this reasoning, and in this case, that certainly won't preclude us from supporting efforts to protect young and vulnerable people from secondary smoke inhalation. And I hope the legislation will have the success that it deserves. Presiding Officer, I'm going to draw my remarks to a close by once again congratulating Jim Hume on his successful efforts to bring Scotland into line with other parts of the United Kingdom and those countries which have similar legislation in place, such as Canada and Australia. There's a general acceptance that the legislation we're approving today will not be a panacea, but that it has the potential, if reinforced by appropriate and ongoing education, and together with the other anti-smoking initiatives as mentioned by the Minister, it has the potential to be of significant benefit to the health of Scotland's children by changing people's attitudes towards smoking in cars with children present. And so, of course, Presiding Officer, we will be joining the rest of the Chamber in voting for the bill at decision time this afternoon. Thank you.
Thanks. And I call on Dr. Richard Simpson. 4 minutes, please, Dr. Simpson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I join with others in congratulating Jim Hume on bringing forward this bill and seeing it through all its processes. I hope to do something of the same in the spring, although I am not getting the government's support in the way he has. And, of course, government support is critical. Smoking and, indeed, alcohol are two of the three big problems with our society. And we've been on a journey to a smoke-free society. I was delighted to be associated with Kenny Gibson's early efforts in 1999. At that time, the evidence of the dangers of secondhand smoke was really much less clear, though, as Jackson Carlow has graphically described in his usual excellent narrative, that the effects were part of common experience, as 70% of people smoked. It took another 6 years for attitudes to change, the evidence to emerge, and eventually the banning legislation. This bill, on the other hand, now has wide public support, as Stuart Maxwell spelled out, even amongst smokers. And even Forest, the tobacco industry-sponsored organisation, has said smoking in cars with children shouldn't happen, although they still oppose the bill. Many other jurisdictions have acted with good results, and there's likely to be reasonable compliance, as I hope, as there was in the ban in public places. When the attitudes are right, then people will actually follow the legislation fairly readily. But we know there are about 60,000 individuals smoking in cars while children are present, so there are a significant number that need to change their behaviour. But as Malcolm Chisholm reminded us, there's also a very strong health inequalities in smoking, and that is true of smoking in cars as well. Now, the details of the background research are, I think, probably well known in the discussions at stage one and in the evidence presented. But Canadian research showed that smoking in a single cigarette in a stationary car with its windows closed is 11 times higher than in the average bar. And as Malcolm Chisholm said, and actually in a moving car, it's still seven times as high. And the thing about opening the window and having the air conditioning on actually doesn't make sufficient difference. There's still a rating of over 100 times greater than the US Environmental Protection Agency's 24-hour standard, 15 times the hazardous rating. So, you know, there's no doubt about this as being a significant element. And the consequences for children are undoubtedly bad. It's worse for children, as many speakers have said, because of their immature lungs and faster rate of respiration. The levels of cotinine have been proved to be much higher in children experiencing secondhand smoke in the same situation as adults. Asthma, for example, can easily be exacerbated, and that number dropped significantly after the smoking ban, the admissions. So I hope we'll see something similar, if not as great, with this ban. One of the interesting pieces of research I came across only last week from Japan is that secondhand smoke is actually strongly associated with dental caries in children, something I had not actually previously thought of. But there is a lot of research that has been shown. Smoke exposure increases the risk of meningitis, that's 18 studies, problems with DMA, stillbirth defects, increased cot deaths, increased levels of meningitis, increased teenage hearing loss with glue ear, worse situation for mental health with hyperactivity and conduct disorders, all these things. Members have referred to the CELSUS reports, and I think it was Stuart Maxwell who said that the numbers are at the lowest that we've seen, which is excellent. Though there is a gender reversal there that is really worrying, and this is reflected, of course, in the adult situation with rising levels of lung cancer in women. I think I've only got 4 minutes, Presiding Officer, so I will move to the end here, just saying this is an excellent bill. But we need to think now about the next steps. What are going to be the next steps? This is a salami tactic that we gradually choke off the tobacco industry, and the faster we do it, the better. So Jenny Mara's suggestion that we need to look at common spaces as a method of extending the ban in public places to stayheads, to closes, I think is welcome. But there's all sorts of legislation abroad which we should look
as
at.
As you said, you were just about to finish, Dr.
I am. So I support this bill, and I support also the call for a debate in, under the government's time on major public health issues. Thank you, President.
Many thanks. I now call on Maureen Watt. 6 minutes, Minister, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank all members for their constructive and almost totally consensual contributions on this very important piece of legislation for the health of Scotland's children. This, I think, is Parliament at its best. And I'd like to take the opportunity again to thank Jim Hume and the Non-Governmental Bills Unit for their work. I'd also like to thank the Health and Sport Committee members for their helpful consideration and that committee's clerks who assisted that work over the last year. And I'd also like to thank my very busy Scottish Government officials in the Tobacco Control Team for all their work on this bill and the health bill, which they have to deal with at the same time. I wish them a good festive season. I thank all those who gave their time to provide evidence to the Health and Sport Committee, almost all of whom advocated that this legislation was both proportionate and necessary. There's been much consensus, and it's great to hear such support for the bill. As I highlighted in my opening statement, the Scottish Government has made clear for some time our commitment to protect children from exposure to secondhand smoke. I know that many others are committed to this same goal. And during the passage of the bill, Cancer Research UK lent their support by saying that making it illegal to smoke in cars with children will help protect them from the hundreds of lethal chemicals, around 70 of which cause cancer, found in cigarette smoke. This bill is an important milestone. It will play its part alongside the vast range of measures that will continue to be progressed by the Scottish Government to reduce tobacco-related harm. It has been 10 years since the introduction of smoke-free legislation. That important step has seen attitudes shift significantly. This is another measure which will build on and continue to drive that change in culture that we wish to see. As James Cant, then head of the British Lung Foundation, when he gave evidence to the committee, said, I envisage that in a couple of years' time, or even sooner, people will look at this issue in the same way that we look at putting a child in their car seat. We have to put the seatbelt on because that is what you do to keep the child or young person safe on that journey. This is exactly what I hope will be achieved. Putting in place robust tobacco control measures is not about stigmatising those who wish to smoke. Ultimately, I think we would all agree that doing all we can to encourage children and young people to choose not to smoke and protecting them from the harm caused by secondhand smoke is necessary. This is another important step in creating a tobacco-free generation in Scotland by 2034. It continues to promote the shift in social attitudes so that choosing not to smoke is the norm. I have had helpful dialogue with Jim Hume throughout the Parliament's consideration of this bill, and we have worked together to improve the bill's provisions. I have always made clear the Scottish Government's support for the underpinning principles. It is my belief that the bill's provisions are strong and the approach taken to implementing this offence is the right one, and we are happy to support this bill at decision time. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Jim Hume to wind up the debate. Mr Hume, you have a generous 8 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. It gives me a great pleasure to know that the bill does cross party lines today. We have a mutual goal of protecting children's health in Scotland, and it does this Parliament proud. As I've said repeatedly, the goal of this bill is to protect children and young people under the age of 18 from the harmful effects of secondhand smoke. I'm really happy to see that the hard work put in by everyone involved in this has resulted in a good, strong, cohesive and effective bill, which I hope and believe will be passed at decision time today. In its journey through the parliamentary procedure, the bill was strengthened at stage two and given unanimous support. We're now faced with the decision of whether to take the last step into passing this bill, which will see at least 60,000 children every week in Scotland benefiting from better health. So at this final stage, detailed scrutiny, input from those 160 that responded to my consultation, the many organisations and individuals mentioned in parliamentary committees has come to a fruition with a bill that will do what it was intended to do. That's protect the vulnerable from the toxic fumes of secondhand smoke in a very enclosed space. So again, I thank all the members on the committees for their constructive work. Again, the ministerial team, fellow members, the numerous charities, organisations, academics and my own office team, Hume, past and present, and good to see one from the past in the gallery today, Craig Moran. So thank them all again. But there is one person I would like to thank, a woman who was selfless throughout her life, gave rather than took, who inspired me and drove me on to make a difference in my community, a non-smoker who died 5 years and 1 week ago today from lung cancer, doubtless brought on from inhaling second-hand smoke. And that was my own mother, Joyce Hume. So I'd like to dedicate this bill to her today. I mentioned the consultation. It gathered wide positive support. Those responses shaped this bill, and it is a credit to this Parliament that we have such a system. And despite differing views on aspects of the bill, we have a bill as the next logical step to protect the health of our children. And I believe it will do so, Deputy Presiding Officer. By developing policies on smoking, we are closing loopholes in legislation that are hazardous to children. As members pointed out, there are significant benefits to people from an early age by cutting down exposure to smoking. Research clearly shows that children who are exposed to secondhand smoke are actually more likely to become smokers themselves, and this is a point which the Public Health Minister also emphasised in the government's Take It Right Outside campaign that she mentioned. But campaigns haven't been enough to protect the 60,000 children every week exposed to secondhand smoke in cars. In its report, the Health and Sport Committee says, and I quote, "Education campaigns alone have not succeeded in protecting children from exposure to secondhand smoke in vehicles, and as such, these further measures are needed." End quote. Deputy Presiding Officer, and change in behaviour is vital. Reducing the exposure to secondhand smoke in vehicles can not only have immediate benefits in protecting children's respiratory systems, but it can also reduce the likelihood that they will develop conditions in the future. We have the chance now to shape a number of preventative measures, freeing up resources from the NHS in the future, but also giving a better chance to get a healthier start in life, saving millions of pounds and lives for generations to come. This is as much about the short-term benefits as it is about ensuring the long-term benefits and prevention from serious diseases such as lung cancer, as I mentioned before. It was a famous inventor who recognised this about 100 years ago, Thomas Edison, believe it or not, and I will quote. He stated, "The doctor of the future will give no medicine, but will interest his patients in the care of the human frame, in diet and in the cause and prevention of disease." End quote. This bill today is in the interest of patients, cares for the human frame, and goes a long way in disease prevention. This future that Edison talked about is now. To truly protect children and their health, we must start by prevention, prevent diseases and remove their catalysts. I have had close and constructive work with the Scottish Government, and I hope that continues into the future as the bill becomes enacted and in place. It's appropriate that legislation designed to protect children must not be burdensome to anyone, confusing or hard to explain. This is why I'm glad that at this stage, this last stage, the bill stands as a clear and simple message to all. It also provides clarity of enforcement for police officers and environmental officers in enforcing the bill's provisions. So to this end, I'm encouraged by the campaign that will be undertaken by Scottish ministers to set the commencement of the bill's provision into force under Section 5. I welcome the high-profile information and awareness campaign that will be given to this important new law. We want more people to realise and understand the detriments to children's health from secondhand smoke, to recognise that opening the window makes very little difference and can, in fact, worsen the intensity of smoke in the rear seats. This campaign can add to the benefits of the purpose of the bill itself, as it can provide positive spillovers and more opportunities for a wider part of the population who may not have children at the moment, but may alter their behaviour when they give their friends a lift to work. Deputy Presiding Officer, I believe the provisions in the bill, as currently stand, can be clearly understood and enforced. I believe they will be effective, encouraging a cultural shift towards healthier habits and a better understanding of the dangers of secondhand smoke, even when it cannot be seen. I also believe that this bill will have a positive impact on improving the health of many future generations to come. This is why voting for this bill is in the interests of parents, children and their future children, that we remove one more factor of harmful health from their lifestyles. The bill has had the backing of the British Medical Association, Scotland's Commissioner for Young Children and Young People, Cancer Research UK, British Heart Foundation, Lung Foundation and many, many more. A long list of supporters and professionals in health, the people who know. It gives this Parliament a good standing to have been one of the pioneering parliaments in Europe to have adopted such legislation. British Heart Foundation recognised this bill's debate as I quote, "the first to introduce the debate about regulating smoking in vehicles in any UK Parliament." And it's sparked great media debate, in their words. And this bill's progress, in British Heart Foundation's words, has led to a ban in England and Wales. so we can be proud that this Scottish Parliament has again led the way in protecting the vulnerable. It will give children a better start in life, knowing that this aspect of their health is legally protected in such an enclosed space. Deputy Presiding Officer, I would like to conclude by again thanking those involved for their cooperative approach. We have a bill today that can give 60,000 children every week in Scotland the healthy start to life that they deserve. And I look forward to support from across the Chamber today at decision time. Many thanks.
And thank you. And that concludes the debate on the Smoking Prohibition, Children and Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15201 in the name of Stuart Stevenson on the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill. I invite members who wish to speak in this debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And Mr Stevenson, I'd like to call on you to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. Please, 6 minutes, so thereby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's always a benefit in reviewing with a critical eye the regimes that govern our work here in Parliament and the work of individual members. The proposals put forward in the bill before us today seek to improve public accessibility of information reported by MSPs, allowing for public scrutiny to be effective. We'll also ensure that a wide range of parliamentary sanctions are available, and it broadens the definition of the serious criminal offence of paid advocacy. At present, due to partial overlaps in the reporting requirements in MSPs under the Parliament's Registers of Interests and the Political Parties Elections and Referendums Act of 2000, otherwise PIPERA, certain financial interests must be reported to both the Electoral Commission and the Parliament. That's dual reporting. The PIPERA requirements are defined in terms of donations for political activities, which includes parliamentary activities, whereas the Parliament is interested solely in financial interests that could be perceived to influence MSPs in carrying out their parliamentary duties. The two regimes have different criteria for registration, which can make the system complex. There are two separate complaints processes, depending on whether an MSP is reported to the Electoral Commission or to the Standards Commissioner for failure to register a financial interest. The committee believes that removing dual reporting will provide for simpler reporting requirements for financial interests overall for MSPs and greater transparency and accountability to the public than is the case at present. This will make details of MSPs' financial interests more transparent, as they were more easily accessible in a single place on our Parliament's website. The means of pursuing a complaint in relation to financial interest will also be streamlined for the public. The bill makes the necessary adjustments to the categories of registrable interest to enable the Electoral Commission to draw all the information they need from the Parliament's register. When dual reporting ends, the Standards Commissioner will take on sole responsibility for investigating breaches of those PIPERA requirements currently investigated by the Electoral Commission, which this bill will incorporate into our revised register of categories. This will broaden the Commissioner's remit and simplify the process for the public, one place for direct complaints. On another matter, the Group of States Against Corruption, GRECO, published a report in 2013 which recommended that consideration be given to lowering the current thresholds for registering gifts. At present, members must register gifts over the value of 1% of a member's salary at the start of the parliamentary session. That makes the current figure £570. The qualification is that it does exclude gifts that don't meet the prejudice test, for example, gifts between members of the MSP's family. Other jurisdictions have lower levels of registration. The House of Commons is going to £300, House of Lords is going to £140, and in Northern Ireland it's £240. With these developments in mind and a desire to increase the transparency of members' interests in this place, the committee decided to include a measure in this bill to lower the threshold for registering gifts. The bill will reduce the threshold for registering gifts to 0.5% of a member's salary, rounded down to the nearest £10, at the beginning of the current parliamentary session. That would presently be £280. Now, let me turn to paid advocacy provisions. Paid advocacy is where an individual uses their position as an MSP to advocate a particular matter in return for payment, including a benefit in kind, or to urge any other MSP to do so. It is a criminal offence and a breach of the Interests Act for an MSP to undertake paid advocacy. As I have stated in previous debates, we first debated the subject in April this year, no MSP has ever been found to be in breach of the paid advocacy provisions. The committee is very clear, given the gravity with which paid advocacy should be treated, that there is a case for increasing the scope of the criminal offence. To that end, the bill amends the existing paid advocacy offence for greater consistency with the Bribery Act of 2010. The paid advocacy offence currently requires actual receipt of an inducement by an MSP or an MSP's partner where this results in some benefit to the MSP. But the Bribery Act 2010 goes further than this. It does not require an individual to actually receive inducements in order to commit an offence, but only to agree to receive such inducements. The committee considers that if an MSP is found to have agreed to undertake advocacy for financial gain or to have encouraged a fellow MSP to do so, they should be considered guilty of an offence regardless of whether the inducements have actually been received. During the Stage 1 debate, Tavish Scott asked me whether this would cover a scenario where a member requests an inducement for advocating a cause. I took the opportunity to amend the bill at Stage 2 to put beyond doubt that this scenario too should be covered by the paid advocacy offence, and we amended it at Stage 2. I move the motion that stands in my name that the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill be passed.
Many thanks. I now call on Minister Joe Fitzpatrick. 3 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm not going to propose to take too much time this afternoon commenting on the details of the bill before us. It will probably come as no surprise that the Government continues to give the Members' Interest Bill its full support. My congratulations go to the members of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, and indeed to its clerks. The committee has made excellent and rapid use of the relevant powers made available to the Parliament under the Scotland Act 2012. The preparatory work to underpin the policy reforms contained in the bill was carefully considered and led to a robust framework, and I think that was added to in terms of the amendments that the convener has just mentioned. And it is obviously worth noting that this is a committee bill. We don't have them that often, so it's useful that we highlight that fact. They're, I think, a useful tool within our parliamentary processes, and I think it's absolutely appropriate that this bill came forward as a committee bill. During the Stage 1 debate, members across the chamber stood together behind these proposals, and I have no reason to consider that position will change today. It's not often that a bill receives such unified support that deserves special mention. At Stage 1, I summarised my broad assessment of what I think the bill delivers, so and the three main things from the Government's perspective. Firstly, it seeks to establish measures to enhance members' accountability to the public, reflecting the latest views as to what constitutes appropriate probity standards. Secondly, looking to standardise arrangements for reporting interests. It streamlines this activity required of members and offers the public a single point of reference and ends the dual reporting that the convener talked about. Thirdly, it offers the Parliament flexibility in the event that circumstances ever arise that necessitate enforcement activity. The bill, therefore, aimed high in seeking to produce a comprehensive review of existing practices, because of those three major areas, any one of them would have been significant for to come forward in the first order. So I think we really can't underestimate the amount of work that went into producing this bill and pulling together these three different strands. I consider every member of this Parliament will benefit as a result of these changes, be that in terms of demonstrating their accountability to their electorate or from the streamlined reporting processes. The proposal to end dual reporting is a significant step forward. I commend the committee for its commitment to that move and the benefits it should deliver for both members of this Parliament and members of the public. The measures in the bill are not just symbolic reforms. They can be characterised as practical improvements which can be realised from the start of the next parliamentary session. Presiding Officer, the Government welcomes the commitment shown by the Standards, Procedures of Public Appointment Committee and look forward to this bill passing at decision time.
Many thanks, Minister. And I now call on Mary Fee. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is a short but nevertheless important debate on the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament. And across the chamber, we all agree that we need robust, accountable and transparent mechanisms for reporting members' interests. And this Parliament rightly prides itself on its openness and accountability. And this bill gives the Parliament the opportunity to revisit the existing legislation surrounding members' interests. And the bill will help to increase transparency and accessibility of information about members' financial interests and will ensure that the Parliament has a robust set of sanctions to deal with any breaches to its rules. And a useful measure included in the bill is the motion of censure, which will serve as a useful middle ground if a member is found to be in breach of the rules, but that breach is not serious enough to justify the removal of parliamentary privilege. A motion of censure would allow debate and would give the member in question the opportunity to explain the breach and apologise. And another useful change is the length of time for which information of members' interests will be kept. And the committee considered it more appropriate to keep register entries for 10 years instead of 5. And there are a number of practical reasons for that. It will assist members by ensuring that information about their previously held interests are available at the start of a session. And similarly, if a member is not returned to Parliament but returns at a subsequent election, it's easier for them to check the interests that were previously recorded. The change will also increase transparency in relation to members' interests, as the information will be easily accessible to the public for longer. And these changes, combined with the changes to the register, will provide an additional layer of transparency to the public seeking to access information on members' interests. And as Stuart Stevenson said in his opening comments, the ending of dual reporting is an important step. At the moment, information is on the Parliament's website and the Electoral Commission website. And that depends on the nature of the interest. And streamlining this process assists people in accessing information and will help members to comply more easily with the regime. And I'm pleased that no member has ever been found to be in breach of the rules in paid advocacy, but we must keep these rules under review, so it's right to strengthen that through this bill. And most members of the public would expect there to be a breach if a member agreed to undertake paid advocacy, even when cash does not change hands. And this bill will ensure that such behaviour will be caught. And the amendments brought forward by Stuart Stevenson at stage 2, which extend section 9 of the bill so that it covers a member or their partner requesting an inducement for the member to carry out paid advocacy, is a further and very useful clarification and a welcome addition to this bill. And can I take this opportunity to thank Stuart Stevenson and the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee and the clerks for the work they have done to progress this important piece of legislation. And I'm pleased to speak today for Scottish Labour and to support this motion, which seeks the Parliament's agreement to the principles of this bill. The provisions will increase transparency and strengthen the standards regime in the Scottish Parliament. Openness, transparency and accountability must be at the forefront of the way in which this Parliament operates, and I am happy to support the motion in Stuart Stevenson's name and support the Members' Interest Bill. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Mary Scanlon. Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I associate myself with the comments made by Mary Fee. I would also like to thank Stuart Stevenson and the Standards and Procedures Committee for bringing forward these amendments to the interest of members of the Scottish Parliament. And can I say, Presiding Officer, it's very nice to have the last debate of the year on a consensual note. But anything that brings greater transparency to this issue has to be welcomed. So, in the interests of clarity, transparency and indeed consistency, I would like to take the opportunity to raise the same question that I raised at stage two, and that relates to benefits in kind. And I do think, given that we have the opportunity for the full chamber to hear, I do think it's appropriate if we could get some clarity on this issue. Now, Stuart Stevenson did say at stage two, it's not currently an offence to receive an inducement as long as the member does not do anything in response to receipt of the inducement, which is fine. He also said it is the conditionality, the link between the benefit that is delivered and the action that the member has taken, that is important. And I think that each and every one of us across this chamber has been invited out to dinner quite regularly, where our hosts tend to take full advantage of the time with us to let us know exactly what their concerns are. So the example that I would like to use today would relate to the UHI college lecturers. If they were to, and if I was still a lecturer, I might be saying to Mr. Matheson to keep a little bit quiet while I speak. I do find it. It was never easy as a teacher when someone chatted in the background. So, cabinet secretary or no cabinet secretary. But if you're invited out to dinner, and if the UHI, for example, highlighted the fact that lecturers in the Highlands are paid £7,000 below lecturers elsewhere in Scotland. Now, Presiding Officer, if I come into Parliament the next week and I raise this issue about the unfair pay to lecturers in the Highlands, then I would just like some clarity. Have I received a benefit in kind? And am I, which was dinner, or am I just receiving information? And do I then become a paid advocate? And I think we would all welcome clarity on that issue. Thank you.
Mr. Stevenson, to wind up the debate, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And let me just start with the point that Mary Scanlon has made, which is a fair and proper point. The example she gives of any of us, being out to dinner with someone who wishes to put a point to us. This is not caught by this unless the dinner is provided on condition that we take an action under the Members' Interests Act. And I think it's that conditionality that is the important point. Now, I will say that Parliament will be likely to be returning to the broader issue that's captured there when we discuss the lobbying bill, because, of course, that may well be that that is a matter of lobbying that will be caught, and the people who are lobbying us would be likely to have to register under the lobbying bill. But, Presiding Officer, that is for another day. But it's the conditionality. We can still go out to dinner. I'm going out tonight, although I think I'm paying, so that certainly won't be caught, the invitations are now closed, Presiding Officer, on that particular subject. Presiding Officer, Mary Fee dealt more than adequately with the subject of the sanctions that are being introduced and the broad sanction regime, in particular the issue of a motion of censure. So I don't propose to say anything material more about that. But I do want to just talk about the removal of dual reporting. Although we will be passing a bill today, it actually cannot proceed as a new part of our law and our procedures here until the Electoral Commission is satisfied that the information in the Register of Interests will be sufficient to meet its needs. The clerks to the committee have been working with the Electoral Commission to ensure the provisions in the bill are satisfactory, and I, like others, thank officials in this Parliament and also at the Electoral Commission for their assistance in this matter. The current framework for ending dual reporting in the Electoral Administration Act 2006 does not extend to independent MSPs, and I want to just say a word or two about that. As that Act stands, dual reporting can only be ended for members of registered political parties and not for independent members. Our bill contains an amendment to that Act which will allow dual reporting to be ended for all MSPs. And I'm pleased to have been able to work with each of the independent members in this Parliament to make sure that the provisions in that regard are understood and agreed. And indeed, I saw Margot MacDonald towards the end of her life. I had a three-minute discussion on this subject and an hour of update on what was going on in Parliament. I won't reveal what I told her about what you were all up to. That would be a breach of confidence beyond what would be proper. In closing, Presiding Officer, I'm pleased the committee has been able to bring forward this committee bill, which I believe will streamline processes for dealing with financial interests, increase transparency, and ensure that we have robust sanctions. I encourage all colleagues to support this change in the next few minutes. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stevenson. I don't expect an answer just now, but maybe when the lobbying bill comes forward, maybe you could tell me if Santa brings me presents, will I be a paid advocate for him? That concludes the debate on the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill. We now would like a motion without notice from the Minister, bringing forward decision time to now.
Moved.
The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 15146, in the name of Jim Hume, on the Smoking Prohibition Children and Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and the Smoking Prohibition Children and Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill is passed. The next question is at motion number 15201, in the name of Stuart Stevenson, on the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill is passed. Can I wish every member a happy, restful and peaceful Christmas and New Year? And I look forward to seeing you all when we return after the recess. That concludes decision time, and I now close this meeting.